Today she's talking about, as I can see here, from leaflets to live stream, protest movements and their media practices. But she could talk about many other things. We've had wonderful conversations. I'm really glad you're here.
Thank you. And I'm really glad that I had the opportunity to be here. And I guess I get the prize for the best integrated scholar also because I was here for quite a long time, 1.5 years. So maybe it would have been embarrassment not being integrated. And it was like a great, like the environment was very amazing. I have to thank, of course, Monroe and CGCS for the support during my time here. I really appreciated all the discussions with all the PhD students and faculty during courses and seminars and invited lectures and so on. So it was a really, really great time here for me. And what I would like to share with you today is parts of my project that I've been working on during this 1.5 years here. And I would like to start with also maybe an apology. So this stuff that I'm going to talk about is quite preliminary. So I'm going to show you some glimpses of my analysis. And I'm, of course, happy for any comments and inputs on my take on this material. And it's also material that's kind of new to me, like it's the first time that I've actually been working with archival material and combining it with in-depth interviews and current media content. So it is quite experimental for me. And what I'm going to do is to start with like a general introduction of my project, like the framing of my postdoc project, which I'm trying to put into a book as well, and then present a bit more concrete analysis that I've been writing in a journal article that's going to be published with Time and Society. But let's get started with the project itself. So this talk, which I called From Leaflets to Live Streams, is integrated in a larger project, which is called Crisis and Critique. And my interest or the initial starting point for this project was my interest in protest movements. So we all remember 2011, the year of protest, and I kind of got interested in all the different movements that were developing, but I also was suspicious, as many people were suspicious about the overemphasis of social media and technologies playing a role for this protest movement. So I thought maybe we need some historical contextualization of the media practices that of course played a significant role for this movement, but there were also so many claims about newness and really significant changes in using media for mobilization, organization, and identification. And I thought like maybe it's time to look back and see how this change, how changes really happened over time. And then I came across, or I've been engaging before with a very great project by Brecht and Benjamin in the 1930s, also in the context of a dramatic big crisis. Where they were thinking together crisis and critique. So they said in the 1930s, with the economic crisis, the Great Depression, this is a moment of a critical moment, a critical juncture, which is potentially opening up new forms of critique and is maybe also requiring new forms of critique in order to make a transition and to progress and to acquire social change. So in that context, I thought maybe this conjunctural moment or critical juncture of crisis is a good entry point in order to make this historical analysis of changing media practices of protest movements. So that's why my project is called Crisis and Critique, to really see over time how maybe new forms of critique in the form of protest movements have been formulated and what kind of media technologies the movements have been employing. So as these critical junctures, I have identified three major points, namely the Great Depression in the 1930s, or starting with 1929, then the fiscal and oil crisis in the 1970s, and then the Great Recession in 2008. And what I'm trying to do is to do a diachronic comparative study of the media practices of protest movements that emerged in the context of this major economic crises. And based on mainstream news media reports, I identified these three protest movements as the most prevalent in the context of this crisis moment, namely the unemployed workers movement, the tenants and squatters movements in the 1970s, and the Great Recession in 2008. And before I go a bit more into detail what my approach is in order to study the media practices of these movements, I'd like to introduce them very quickly. And while I keep on talking, I hope that it works. There are some images in the background that we also get some visual impressions of the movements. So the first movement, as I mentioned before, is the unemployed workers movement that emerged following the stock exchange crash in 1929, where the number of unemployed in the US really exploded from 500,000 in October 1929 to more than 4 million in January 1930, and the numbers kept on growing and up until 9 million in October 1931. And while there was a lot of unemployment, the ones still in employment were faced with shrinking salaries. They were on part-time employments. So it really affected broad branches of the American society and globally as well. And that was also expressed in, it had effects on malnutrition and diseases that were spreading, and so it really had crucial impact on society. And in the beginning of the Great Depression, most of the unemployed and people suffering in this context did that alone, like on an individual level. There was no feeling of a shared experience of this precarious situation, but it was rather trying to cope with it on an individual level, like trying to mobilize family members, borrowing money all over, starting to wander around the country trying to find employment. So there was no shared sense of these are structural issues that need structural answers, but rather an individual coping with the situation. And in that moment, different organizations tried to organize the unemployed in order to advocate for the structural changes in order to improve the situation. Because there was no social release system in place, there was no unemployment insurance and so on. So, for example, the Communist Party and the Socialist Party started to advocate for different actions and try to organize the unemployed. But there were also other associations, such as the Labor Research Association, that tried to gather data about unemployment in the first place, because there weren't any information how many are actually unemployed, what are the effects on a daily basis for these people, and so on. So they tried to gather this information. And you also had very local, smaller organizations, like in New York, the Greenwich House, that were housing meetings of different smaller unemployment groups, and, for example, artists that were unemployed. But we also had the League for Industrial Democracy, and they were already starting to reach out to broader publics by organizing public lectures that were also recorded and broadcasted on radio in order to create this shared sense of this is a situation which needs to be addressed on a higher political level. So as I already said, these organizations employed a rather sophisticated set of different media, ranging from factory papers that were produced by unemployment workers and distributed in the factories by workers. They also used the radio as a kind of emerging becoming bigger as a medium in the households at that time. And there's actually quite comprehensive study by Harold Laswell about the communist media, which was published in 1939, which is like really describing the different media technologies that were used by that time. And the second movement, as I said, is the tenants' movement in the 1970s. And actually, the 1970s are a bit different compared to the 1930s, because there you couldn't really discern a mass protest movement. So although in the beginning of the oil crisis in 1973, analysts made this comparison to the Great Depression, that it was like as severe and big as the Great Depression in the 1930s, the biggest crisis since a rather economically prosperous time in the 1960s. However, there weren't any large-scale mass protests coming up compared to what happened in the 1930s and the workers' movement there. And Manuel Castells discusses in his book, Economic Crisis in the American Society, why there weren't any mass protests. And he argues that on the one hand, you had like a growing police violence and more like, for example, there were new special units in police force that kind of threatened people to really engage in mass protests, for example. At the same time, you had an ideological delegitimization of political protests since the late 60s and the civil rights movement there, as well as you had an absence of an immediate political alternative, which led to this kind of emptiness in terms of mass protests. But what we had were institutions and movements that were there before, but that kind of changed their practices in the 1970s in the context of this economic crisis. And the tenants' movement is one major example here. And I've been mainly looking at one of the largest tenants' organizations in New York, which organized around the Met Council on Housing. And in the 1970s, the Met Council on Housing was actually opening up for new political other groups. For example, they started to collaborate with the Black Panthers and the Young Lords. They kind of, after decades of advocating for tenants' rights in New York and realizing that the typical way of trying to push for change with the politicians and so on doesn't work, they opened up and kind of radicalized. And they also, it was a contested situation, like people accused them of maybe putting off middle-class people that would engage in the movement. But in the end, this was kind of what happened in the context of the economic crisis. And they were, of course, the media environment in which they acted was rather different or very different compared to the 1930s. And we had a much more complex media ecology. And they reacted to this media ecology with now also the television as an important channel with professionalization. So they were really trying to educate activists within the organization in how to engage with mainstream media and to get visibility in TV, for example. But I'm going to talk a bit more about this in just a second. And the last movement is probably the one that everybody can relate to best. It's the Occupy Wall Street movement. And I'm also particularly focusing on the encampment in New York. And it's quite difficult to actually narrate what this movement is about, like what are the demands. There's a discussion, were there any demands, were there no demands? It was an explicitly multi-voiced movement, which makes it so difficult to provide this major narrative of what this movement is about. And it's maybe also too early to actually discuss the consequences and the meaning of the movement. But what I would try to do is like reconstruct the, one of the typical stories that was told about the movement, just to give a background. So most of the reports or stories now about Occupy start with the launch of the hashtag Occupy Wall Street by Ed Busters in July 2011. After which, on September 17th, around like some thousand people followed this call and showed up on Wall Street. But since it was highly police secured, they turned to the nearby Saccotti Park, which became the place for deliberation, discussions, and organization of different direct actions for the next couple of weeks until November, when the first eviction happened. And Occupy, since like I started the story about Occupy with the hashtag, Occupy has often been described as this movement facilitated by social media, which really like made it as big as it was, since there was a major news blackout from mainstream media during the first couple of days of occupation. So, and that's something I'm going to focus on later as well, what role they really played. But just to contextualize my project a bit more theoretically, why am I choosing these quite disparate movements and compare them? And here I'm kind of referring or drawing on what Sieber has called an eventful history, arguing that different like conjunctural moments as crisis, economic crisis moments, have the potential to really change historical developments and transform social relations. So in that sense, my historical study is quite different from previous studies that maybe traced histories of singular movements back and kind of wrote a genealogy of these movements, how they developed over time. But I'm really much more interested in the change as such, like not what happened particularly with this movement, but what happened to them in the context of changing media technologies for the practices of these movements. And also in the paper, I'm drawing on specific events that were crucial for these movements in order to make these comparisons. So for example, for the unemployed workers movement, I'm looking at the International Day of Unemployment, which were like major marches all over the country. Then I'm looking at the housing crimes trial in New York for the tenants movement, and then the March on Brooklyn Bridge, and how the different activists were using media technologies in order to organize and mobilize for these events. And when it comes to the material, I'm also drawing on quite diverse materials, and I've organized it now around three major tropes, like entry points, how you search an archive. It's basically organized around this. So I've been looking at central figures in the movements, for example, activists like William Z. Foster in the unemployment workers movement, or Jane Benedict for the tenants movement, and then I've tried to get at their personal paper collections. I've also read autobiographies by activists, and I'm trying to get access to FBI records of central organizers, which is a long administrative process. And I'm not sure how far I'm coming with this, but I thought it might be interesting because in the 1930s, a lot of people were also arrested just for distributing leaflets. So I thought it might be interesting to also have a look at these files. And for the Occupy Wall Street movement, I've also conducted in-depth interviews with people that were involved with the press working group and the media working group. Similar then, I organized or I accessed materials around the organizations that were central for this movement. I was looking at minutes from meetings. I also had access to research collections, like research actually done on the movements already, and you kind of had the backstage access to the studies. For example, for the tenants' movement, there's a quite extensive study, and you can have access to the research collection and also see protocols and interview materials transcribed and so on. So that was quite interesting as well. And then, of course, I looked at the media productions by the movements themselves, but also mainstream newspaper articles. And what I think also found quite fascinating was the hard drive with born digital materials by the Occupy Wall Street movement that is accessible for everybody at the Interference Archive in Brooklyn, where the archiving working group started to archive the movement itself. So they started to collect pictures, footage from different protest actions with metadata, like about the events and who was taking the pictures and taking the clips, but also different artistical expressions. They also collected tweets and started to analyze the material. And then they had different data sharing days where they all came together and looked at the material together. So that was quite exciting to look at as well. But that's for the project in general. And what I would like to do now is turn to one more specific analysis that I have written an article about, where I focus on the question of time and media technologies. Rather, like the article is called Regimes of Time Media Practices of the Dispossessed, and where I'm really looking at what kind of temporalities the media technologies employed allow for, or how they structure practices in terms of temporality by the movements. And I mean, the relationship between media technologies and time is quite obvious. Like, Media organize our time, they help us organize our time in everyday life. They help us remembering the past, they help us planning the future, and they allow what Patty Scannell has called common public time. So they also allow for shared experiences in terms of temporality. And that's, I thought, was an interesting entry point to bring these three protest movements into conversation with each other. And what I kind of identified for the media technologies employed is that we have a change from mechanical speed in the 1930s to a perpetual flow and then towards digital immediacy. And that's these three steps of change I would like to explain a bit further in the following. These are like typical examples of media outlets or like leaflets in the 1930s. So in the 1930s, the production of bulletins and shop papers was self-organized by the unemployed. And as Laswell and Blumstock remark in their study of the revolutionary propaganda, the shop unit was usually responsible for gathering material, and special shop paper committees were formed in order to produce these shop papers that were then distributed in the factory. And they not only, as I said also before, they not only contained information about relief opportunities, like where they had to turn in order to get support, but also they shared basically everyday experiences of unemployment. Like, people were narrating their everyday life. How did they experience it? Which is contributing to this identification and realizing, okay, it's not only me, it's like a lot of other people that have similar problems. And during the peak time of organizing, there were hundreds of these shop papers and bulletins all over the country that were produced collectively and distributed. And sometimes, as I said, people were also threatened to lose their jobs, or in case of leaflets for demonstrations, there was also the threat of getting arrested. So, but what are then the characteristics of this production process in the area of mechanical speed? Or why are they representations or examples of mechanical speed? And here I thought Walter Benjamin is, of course, again, very helpful to understand how these media technologies really worked, and his essay, The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction from 1936, where he discusses this point of media images being reproducible now and how this changes. Not only the aura, which is like the point that a lot of people are emphasizing, that the original art piece of art or media image loses its specific aura since it's being reproduced. But it's not only that, it's also that it gains mobility. So he said, technical reproduction can put the copy of the original into situations which would be out of reach for the original itself. Above all, it enables the original to meet the beholder halfway. So this argument basically suggests a democratization of media images by being reproduced, and also that that they gain in political potential to be spread to the masses, in order to resist against oppression and mobilize for political change. So with technologies like the mimeograph that the unemployed workers were using in order to produce large numbers of these pamphlets and bulletins, they also had the potential to reach out to more workers and, you know, spread the experience and information that were gathered in these papers. So you had a kind of mechanical acceleration of speed in spreading, distributing these information and experiences, the meaning captured in this pamphlets. In contrast, in the 1970s, as I said before, the media sphere or the media landscape was much more complex, and besides printed media outlets and the radio, activists also engaged with the now dominant medium television and its very own properties at that time. And in the context of a growing economic crisis in the early 1970s, especially in New York, that was also faced with a fiscal crisis, so there were large budget cuts for public services and so on at that time. Different small-scale movements, urban movements, became increasingly radicalized, as I said, when I introduced the tenants' movement and took the example of the Metropolitan Council on Housing. Especially after 1973, there was numerous new activists and organizations that aim to organize specifically within the tenants' movement. And they organized one large-scale event that I have been looking at more closely, namely the housing crimes trial, where tenants were asked to witness about their everyday life situation and had the opportunity to share their experiences there. And in the back you can see like the judges that were judging the landlords and the city officials for this very severe housing crisis at that time. And in preparation for this event, for example, but also for other direct actions that the tenants' movement was organizing, they really were reaching out to mainstream media. And as I said, the Metropolitan Housing Council was very professional in this practice. So they had different workshops on publicity and how to write a press release, but also trainings and how to interact with television and interact with news reporters at these kind of events. Like, were really trained in order to intercept in this perpetual flow of this very complex media sphere at that time, which reminded me, or with television becoming such a important node for the activists as well, it reappears in the materials that they really try to attract TV to come to the events and report from there. However, television was also at that time characterized by this constant flow, this perpetual flow that Raymond Williams was describing at that time, where he speaks about how moving away and programming from separated sequences to a constant flow to capture the attention of the viewer for the whole evening and without real beginnings and real endings. So the commercial breaks, but also the, you know, introducing spots before the next segment created this constant flow. And in that situation, of course, the activists had to be very professional to intercept in this perpetual flow of constant constant TV screening in order to get visibility and being heard. But at the same time, it's of course also an acceleration of speed compared to the 1930s, like how quickly you can reach out to more people and attract attention. And this acceleration is of course continued today, where we where I would say we are facing a situation of digital immediacy. And many commentators, as I've said before, have started to tell the story of Occupy Wall Street with the Adbusters' launch of the hashtag to Occupy Wall Street. Although there might have been earlier mobilizations that can be connected to the movement as well, it was like from the very beginning built around this narrative of the importance of social media for Occupy. And it's also when you turn to academic analysis, you see a lot of numbers talking about Occupy, like how almost 100,000 YouTube clips were uploaded only 3 months after the initial occupation, but also the mentions on Twitter, how they kept on growing. And it's really a focus on the large numbers of tweets, YouTube clips and Facebook posts that is emphasized here, showing the importance of social media. And also the activists themselves describe media technology as very important and prevalent in the movement. And one of my informants, for example, said, a lot had to do with technology. They've organized a fucking media center. I don't know what they were doing, if it was all organized through them, but they must have done something right, because I've never seen something like that before. It was young people organizing it. You know, I've been to like mass protests in DC, in New York, and other places that had press teams, but never like a media team with laptops and video fucking cameras, fucking everything. They were so decentralized, but organized. They seemed to be very busy. So early on, the media working group contributed to this constant stream of tweets, blogs, and Facebook posts. They also had a 24 hours live stream from the camp with programming elements, interviewing activists in the camp, but also passers-by, and had different musical performances for the live stream as well. So the group and its affiliates produced a constant flow of images, memes, and texts to be circulated, which was born out of the necessity, of course, as well. Aiming for visibility of the movement, of the activists, of the discussions happening in the camp. But at the same time, they also contributed to the production of digital media content that is part of what Jody Dean has called communicative capitalism. And she argues that communicative capitalism predominantly builds on the logic that exchange value is more important than use value. And this emphasis on numbers, the numbers of YouTube clips and tweets, is very illustrative of this argument. So it wasn't about what actually was exchanged and circulated, but it was about the sheer amount of tweets and memes and pictures. And part of communicative capitalism is also the acceleration of speed in this circulation. So the social media that the activists employed are built on the logic of newness. So it's about uploading new stuff all the time. And at the same time, within social media, the category of producing and consuming are kind of collapsed. So while you're producing, you're also consuming the content. So in that sense, it's the absolute acceleration of speed to digital immediacy. However, I would argue this can become problematic for movements such as Occupy Wall Street as well, because the movement was also a micro experiment in participatory practices that need time for deliberation, for exchange, for discussions, that is reflected in a lot of accounts of like endless meetings of the General Assembly or the Spokes Council. But this seems to be in a stark contrast with the logic of digital immediacy and the constant circulation of new images and new messages, and where I think there's happening a kind of desynchronization between machine time of social media and political time of participatory practices. So that is something I'm also looking into further. So in the paper, the conclusion is, or what I'm following, is the acceleration of speed in production, distribution, and consumption since the 1930s. And maybe also the effects of this acceleration, so the desynchronization between political time and media time. But what I also thought was kind of interesting is that it was mainly banal media technologies or taken for granted media technologies that were employed, although there are different theorists and commentators that have said that especially marginalized groups are the ones driving innovations, specifically in the media sector as well, in order to challenge monopolies of knowledge and so on. However, the most important media technologies for the movements were the established ones. Like, they tried to reach out to mainstream news media, the television, and also for Occupy Wall Street, they used the established platforms like Facebook and Twitter. Even if there were attempts to innovate and maybe build new networks, the major work was done in this taken for granted media technologies, which is kind of qualifying or questioning this focus on newness and this assumption that have been made about media technologies in connection with protest movements. But also it's interesting to look at how they are trying to carve out their discursive spaces within this established media ecologies. And as I said, there's this kind of desynchronization between media and political practices. So these are the general kind of conclusions for this paper. And what I'm looking at now and trying to develop my project further is especially looking at this desynchronization and trying to discern the difference between machine time and political time and argue for repoliticization of media technologies as well for protest movements. But I've been also interested in how the construction of space and spatial practices are changing over time. So this is something I've been looking at. And since, I said in the beginning, I've been working for the first time with archival material. So I've also been interested in the notion of the archive itself. So maybe working more with also community archives and the idea of preserving the history from below, from the activists themselves. Why activists think that it's important and what maybe digital media offer them to do so. So, that's also something I'm working on. That's it.
So sure there are many questions. I was going to ask one to begin with, which is how, this is a personal interest of mine, is you as a person coming from the DDR and your socialization as a child and how that affects your framing and your development of this agenda. So it's really interesting that you, it's such an American study, but it's an American study against a historical background. And so maybe you could.
I'm not sure if I think I was a bit too young to be really socialized in the GDR. So when the war fell, I was six. I mean, of course, the legacy of GDR culture is still there and prevalent, and it's. But it's more interesting for me now to see new movements emerging in the area. You probably have heard about the anti-Islamic movements that are growing, specifically in my hometown and in Dresden, like Leipzig and Dresden, and which is has been linked to the GDR history as well, like politics of the GDR and how they excluded migrant workers and the lack of experience with non-Germans in this area has often been used as explaining why they are so growing so big there. For me personally, I think I would have to think about it more. I don't know how to answer this question.
One which is very peculiar to you as a person coming with your historical, educational, and geographical background, as opposed to how an American PhD student would frame these three events, etc. It sort of rang through, as I heard it, it had intimations of the 30s and, in ways it might not be true of someone who's been socialized here as a PhD scholar.
Yeah, but that's something not able to answer, or I wouldn't know.
So first, thank you for a fascinating talk. I especially appreciate your historical approach. And I have a very quick methodological question and then a theoretical question. When you're doing your research on it, trying to get the FBI files, are you using Freedom of Information Act requests? Okay, so I'll need to talk to you about that. And then the second question is, looking at this question of time, have you considered, in terms of the political time, have you considered the time that it takes for these broader political processes? Like, so it seems like there's also a disconnect between the immediacy and then the slow slog of social change, institutional change over time. I think that's something that Occupy has certainly been criticized for. So if you looked at that.
Yeah. I mean, it's also, I've been really simplifying here because, of course, there's not one machine time. Like, there are different temporalities within social media as well. So it's not as clear-cut as I'm trying to put it here. But there are also different temporalities in the political process. So on the one hand, you have this long processes in representative democracy, the legal process and so on. On the other hand, you have like maybe more revolutionary times where it's quicker, where things are happening quicker. But I think in general, I'm more interested in the disconnect, like how quick it is in terms of machine time and how comparatively slow it is in terms of political time. And especially when it comes to Occupy Wall Street, I think this point that time, more time was needed is very valid because it was such a disparate group of people that had so many disagreements about the process, like, and tactics, like what they should be doing, what the goals are, is it reform, is it revolution, and so on. So they would have needed more time to elaborate on it and find their niches, maybe also like the way out for them was this diversity in tactics and allowing very, very different approaches there. But it's also when it comes to reflecting about the movement that would have needed more time, I think, like deciding is it was it a success or a failure and so on. I think it needs more time there as well.
I just want you to like elaborate more on this point, because it seems part of the argument is that there are different temporalities within media that are reflected in parallel with different temporalities within political practices. Rather than there are two different temporalities per se between media practices and political practices. It's interesting that the slide before, like the two images that you chose about Occupy Wall Street, one talked about like the Tahrir moment, like a moment that is fast, while the other one was like this flow that's similar to television before. So do you think that like these different temporalities are reflected in political, in the temporalities of political practices in the same way?
No, but that's exactly my point, which is problematic, I think, that the problem is, okay, so there are multiplicities of temporalities in both realms, but they are not connected any longer, I would say, or there's a growing disconnect there. So if you say maybe there, at some point there was a reflection of media technological time in the political process or the other way around, this disconnect is growing, I would argue. And that at that, specifically, that's why activists need to reconsider the political structuration of media technologies and maybe develop new technologies or employ them differently, consider them as part of the struggle in a way.
Why don't you call people? It's too hard for me.
Oh, okay. Brian.
I have a question about the way that Lisa Occupy Wall Street seems to reference other protest movements. Are there similar echoes of other awareness of or like the employment of other kinds of organizational moments that get roped into the other two protest movements that we're studying?
Okay, then let's maybe start with the tenants movement. The tenants movement in New York specifically has a very long history, which like some people said started in 1904 with like the first rent strike by Jewish tenants. So then continued. They developed their practices or their approaches, their tactics in order to improve the situations of tenants according to the political context, of course. But especially the Metropolitan Council on Housing is very aware of this long history. And when you go to their website, they have a historical, part as well, where they recount the long history of the tenants' movement in New York.
Seems to be.
Yeah, but that's why the tenants' movement is so interesting in the 1970s, because it seems like a rupture in their tactics. Like before, they were mainly employing like rent strikes, and they were providing information for tenants what they could do on the individual level. In the 1970s, the Met Council was really opening up for other organizations and more radicalizing also in the political sense, and saying trying to talk to city officials is not enough anymore. We need more media attention and really radical changes. So that's also the moment where they really professionalized in their media practices. So it's like both continuation and new tactics.
Okay, Kate.
I was wondering actually if you could sort of summarize for us like what the calendar time of these different events was, and because I'm interested within that sort of calendar time, if there is a sort of sense that you can't get anything done because you have to perpetually produce, is that increases towards Occupy?
If I should just provide the time frame for the unemployed workers movement, I start with the 1929 crash until 1934 approximately, when like New Deal really kicks in and so on. But it's like I thought this is really the initial phase of mobilizing the workers' movement by the different organizations. And for the tenants' movement, I started in 1970 until 74 approximately. But I'm also, you know, according to the material that I'm still also gathering, I'm also open to like broaden this time frame. And for Occupy, I was mainly looking at the time frame from September 2011 to like spring 2012. But I also did interviews. So, and there the people had their own time frame of Occupy, of course. So I wasn't like, so what happened from September so and so until, but it was more like, what's your story? What's your experience with Occupy? So in that sense, it's also, it doesn't really fit the frame, but yeah.
Yeah, and I guess I was sort of thinking about like sustainability in those terms, whether it, like other things, I think the meme time, for example, distorts our sense of how long lasted and how long they've taken and when they started and when they end. Mm-hmm. So thinking about, whenever a meme arises, it feels like it disappears and it disappeared ages ago when actually it was only months ago. And yeah. I think that speaks to why your idea about how this disconnect between political time, which requires so much, is like, it's really powerful. So thank you.
I know this is sort of like the flip side and not really what you're focusing on, but I'm just wondering if people have written about the relationship between these moments of economic crisis and the changes in temporal and in temporality in media that you're talking about, whether there's a sort of like media accommodation or sort of like the way that media technologies develop in relation to this history of capitalism, sort of contradictions working themselves out, mm-hmm. And if that has a part to play in the
I mean, not, of course, not the way I'm doing it, not that I'm aware of, but I mean, I try to get this as well by turning to contemporaries, like by taking Walter Benjamin's essay, by looking at Raymond Williams' television essay and so on. So looking at how they were analyzing the contemporary media landscape. So in that way. Maybe.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Oh, was that?
No. Who was it, Anne?
You go first. Okay, great. Thanks. Thanks very much for this. And my question is about access issues and sort of, you know, all these are movements of, in one way or another, the dispossessed. And I'm wondering if in your research you've seen any commonalities or differences across these movements in terms of, you know, uptake of different communication technologies of the time based on reaching out to, you know, the sort of strategically reaching out to the groups that they're trying to mobilize here, and whether, you know, there's a temporal aspect of that too in terms of the development of these technologies over time and the ability to bridge media divides.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that's exactly what I'm trying to get at. But it's also, there's a constraint, and when you think of access, also how archives work and what's preserved in the archives. So I've also had questions about, you know, when you present the unemployment workers' movement, it's very this institutionalized way of activism. Were there any non-institutionalized forms as well? But this is really a question of access and what's preserved in like institutions like the archive, which are organized around famous people and organizations. So maybe more non-institutionalized forms wouldn't end up there, or it's really difficult in a systematical way to find them. I mean, I'm also, you know, trying to develop a feeling, or like reading novels from the time that are tackling contemporary issues and so on, in order to see maybe some alternative narratives there as well. But it's like not in a
very,
yeah. Yeah.
To take a stab at the biographical question, I wonder if there isn't like a latent Marxist strain to your thought in some ways, because it seems like the contradiction you're identifying is even maybe a broader contradiction between capital and democracy. And maybe if you locate it in that way, you could get a larger literature to draw on.
Yeah, definitely. But I'm not sure if they were teaching Marxism in kindergarten. So
I don't know what your kindergarten was like.
Probably, implicitly. For example, Jody Dean's idea of communicative capitalism and the discussion of exchange value versus use value is
exactly this. Yeah. I just want to follow up on that really quickly. The acceleration of speed production and distribution function is like a family out of Marxist thought. Like, if you look at David Harvey and stuff, developing his ideas from the Guadressa, it's very much about those components. So there's spots there. Okay.
Thanks. Kevin? Oh, sorry.
I want to ask you about what you left off with, which is about like how this kind of research changes what we think of as an archive. It seems, I don't know, this is just a hunch, but it seems like maybe because of the immediacy that you locate as the kind of temporal condition of the most contemporary mobilizations, that immediacy creates maybe a bias towards digital archival practices that misses the materiality approach. So there's like a ton of attention given to tweets now as this emerging archival form, when actually, like, if you go to the protests, there's like an enormous amount of stuff, like things that I wonder, I mean, this is just me speculating, that I wonder if that, you know, that kind of immediacy and the tendency towards a new emerging digital archive means that we are now like not thinking of collecting the signs or at Occupy, like all of the stuff at the camps. I don't know. That's just a thought, but do you have thoughts about that?
It's definitely an important discussion. So in archival studies, you had similar, this euphoric claims that are linked to digital media, and people were saying, yeah, this is like a new moment in archiving stuff. It's now very affordable. Everybody can do it. You don't need a lot of space. You don't have to maybe think about preserving these materials, and it's very easy. So a lot of academics also argued that it's a new movement, like community archiving with the help of digital media is becoming very big. But my own experience with the interference archive is that they are also archives that are having this material aspects as well, and for them it's like they are collecting everything, and for them the main point is not why for more institutionalized archives it's about preserving also and being very careful with the materials. For them it's about access, that people can actually touch and feel the materials and work with them rather than preservation. But it's like definitely there was a similar euphoric moment with archival studies and digital media. Finally, sorry.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the connection between the temporal disconnect between media and political practices, and also the maybe growing spatial disconnect, so how things are moving from the local to the global, and how political practices have been situated in local traditionally, and less so in the national, and less so in the global. And you're not really looking at how something like Occupy has been globalized, but you had the Occupy video clip that you had was from RT, and maybe how that locational and spatial gulf is maybe widening the temporal gulf.
Yeah. That's definitely also something I'm very interested in. And I mean, there have been theoretical discussions about the death of distance and the role of space because of the potential of media technologies connecting places. But I would anyway argue that the spatial component, also the local one, remains very important. Although Occupy became this umbrella or meta, like traveling narrative for other occupations around the world, actually being in this square physically over a longer period of time was one of the major tactics of resistance. Like also, you know, interrupting the flow of the city, which was always also important for other movements before, when the marches in DC in the 1930s were blocking the traffic. Similarly, these spatial practices were important for Occupy as well. Like I think there is a broadening in terms of like global reach, and that other localities know about it, but this very spatial aspect is also remained very important. And also the traveling of the narrative, like in this other locations with encampments as well. For example, I was looking at Occupy Stockholm. They reframed the story of Occupy for the local purposes, and like refer to very specific local political problems. So like housing crisis in Stockholm and these kind of things. So there's a global reach, but it, the spatial local
right,
connections are still.
Quality, like, politics, so mm-hmm. people who are maybe not out in Zuccotti Park but are sitting in their living rooms, I mean, how does that increase the gap between the local practices?
Yeah, and then also these different engagements with different mobilizations and courses also is very, like, passes by for the one at home very quickly as well. As Kate said before, like, the meme appears and disappears, and it feels like years. It's been years, and then you recognize it again, and it was just last week that it was circulated so widely. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. And thank you again for the award as the most integrated business.